It's Wednesday, February 22nd, 2017. I'm your host, Sarah Mannell. We have a great show in store for you today. Some Cape Towns are concerned about the cost of a proposed new Cape Cod Regional Technical High School. We chat with Finance Director Mark Milne to find out how these developments will affect Barnstable. The state's Alcohol Beverage Control Commission says Barnstable can license more seasonal package stores. We're going to learn more about that with Consumer Affairs Supervisor Elizabeth Hartsgrove. And we'll find out about a project to dress up downtown Hyannis with Main Street Business Improvement Director Elizabeth Werfbein. All of that on this episode of Barnstable Today. But first, let's get right into the newscast for today. A popular road race may disrupt traffic around town next weekend. Police Chief Paul McDonald says the Hyannis Marathon takes place Sunday, February 26th.
It's both a half marathon and a full marathon. We expect between 2,000 to 3,000 runners participating in it because this is the last qualifying event for the Boston Marathon. So we have some high-class professional runners at this. It does cause a lot of traffic concerns for us. We will have the traffic boards out there. There will be detours. There will be road closures. We are planning on doing a reverse 911 to the entire town to let people know. You know, it starts at the Resort and Conference Center right there on Scudder Avenue. It goes down towards South Street, right on C Street, and spends the first couple of miles in South Hyannis, then goes through Hyannisport, out in the center of up Craigville, then back through Hyannisport, and then back to where it started at the Hyannis Conference Center. So it's going to be traffic gridlock, and we're just going to ask everybody just try to stay away from that area as much as humanly possible.
For detailed information about the marathon and traffic patterns, you can visit the Barnstable Channel 18 Facebook page. We are all itching for spring, and so is the town's Department of Public Works. DPW Director Dan Santos says this spring his crews will get started on a few very important projects.
We have a number of projects that have been in the planning and design stage for a couple of years, and they're going to be coming to fruition this spring, and that includes a redesign of the parking area over at Joshua's Pond in Osterville, where we're going to be improving the flow of traffic into that small area, having a better layout for parking, and also improving the drainage there, which currently basically drains into the pond, which these days we don't like to do that. So we're going to be capturing that drainage and dealing with that. So that's a welcome project, particularly because it's a very popular beach and it's really difficult to park there in the summer, and we'll be able to provide some relief there with this project. So the people in Osterville are looking forward to that.
Yeah, always welcome. Yes. When we have additional parking spaces.
Yes, and we are finishing up the design on the Barnstable Dog Park, which is going to be going on Finney's Lane over by Hathaway's Pond entrance. And we have been provided design and construction funding from the Stanton Foundation. I think they're in Cambridge, and they support dog parks across the country. And they're paying most of the cost of us installing a dog park there. And there's a Barnstable Dog Park group that's been meeting for a couple of years and raising funds on their own for long-term operation and maintenance of this. And so I know those folks are very excited about having that get underway and having a place so they can exercise their dogs and themselves.
Santos says the department will also oversee the building of 5 new art shanties. Those will be located in the green space next to Town Hall, also known as Ruth Rusher Park. The town's finance department receives competitive bids from bond and note underwriters for more than $10 million. Morgan Stanley & Company was the winning bidder for the bonds, with an average interest rate of 2.74%. The bond and note proceeds will be used to finance various municipal purposes. Prior to the sale, S&P Global Ratings affirmed the town's AAA bond rating. Sandy Neck staff are working to build a lean-to, or shelter. The project started when an Eagle Scout made a tenting platform where a derelict cottage was torn down. The plan is to add a lean-to or shelter on that platform. Staff will present plans to the Old Kings Highway Historic Committee tonight at 6:30. That meeting takes place at the West Barnstable Community Building. Up next, we're going to chat with Finance Director Mark Milne. Joining me now over the phone is Finance Director Mark Milne. I want to talk to you, Mark, about something that could really impact a Barnstable. Mashpee Selectmen are considering withdrawing from the Cape Tech. That will have, if that happens, that would have some pretty big financial repercussions for other towns that pay into Cape Tech, including Barnstable. How would that affect our finances?
Well, you know, a large portion of the technical school's budget is allocated to each member town based on their student population. So if one of those communities, especially a larger one like Mashpee, which sends around 60 children to that school, were to pull out, the budget's not going to change immediately in any significant way. There probably would be some reduction. However, that means more of the fixed costs are still going to be there, and more of those fixed costs will be allocated to Barnstable because there's fewer kids to allocate those costs to. So it would have a pretty significant impact, I believe, if one of these larger towns were to pull out of a regional school district.
They had voiced concerns, I think, about the cost of a new building. How will those expenses be distributed among towns?
Yeah, again, those the cost of that project is significant, and that will be distributed, again, based on that student population. So we went to a meeting last week. Mashpee officials were at that meeting, as well as officials from all other towns that send students there, and everyone shared their concerns with the superintendent that, you know, the cost of this project is so significant, it would have, you know, a devastating financial impact on every community. For example, the town of Barnstable's assessment from the school would jump from $3.2 million to $5.1
million.
Wow. So it's a $1.8 million increase in the assessment
per year
for the town of Barnstable, and that's significant. That's a 54% increase. In a recurring cost, that's a recurring increase too. So,
and is that per year, Mark?
Per year for 30 years, yeah. The cost of that project, they're looking at $141 million new school construction, added with all the financing costs with the bonds that they would have to float to pay for it. It ends up being about $192 million project over 30 years with interest. And our share of that, kind of Barnstable share, would be about $1.8 million for 30 years.
Wow.
Significant amount of money.
And when you say $1.8 million, that $1.8 million is every year for 30 years.
Every year for 30 years, yep. It's about $54, $55 million of the cost would be allocated to Town of Barnstable. And Mashpee was, and the impact to them was close to $700,000 a year, so... So every community there was concerned with the cost of this project and the financial impact it would have. And many communities there also expressed that the only way to pay for something of this magnitude would be through a Proposition 2.5 tax override. That requires a vote of the taxpayers in each community. So every community is going to have to go out, put a ballot question on the ballot and see if the voters would approve that cost to be added to the tax levy. If the voters were to approve this project but not approve the override, we're going to have significant impacts on other areas of the operating budgets. And one official from another town said, basically, you know, you're pitting fire and police departments against school departments in every community.
And why do you say that? Explain that to me a little bit.
Well, because we'd have to cut the budgets in order to pay for this increased assessment. Where are you going to get the money to allocate it from? You're going to have to reduce budgets. And what are the departments that cost the most? Fire and police.
Interesting.
Next to schools. And so you're going to take money, you're going to have to allocate money from those operations to pay this increased regional school district assessment.
Now, you were talking about approval of the project and then a separate approval of funding for the project. My
yes.
question to you is, if it is a project that involves many communities, where does the voter approval happen? I mean, would this be something that Barnstable voters would also see, or is this just out of our hands?
The way the regional school district agreement works is that the school district has the authority to place a ballot question on a ballot, place a question on a ballot, in every town that belongs to the regional school district. And that question would be whether or not the voters in each one of those towns approves of this new school building construction. The ballot question does not include anything about how to pay for the project. It's just whether or not they approve the project to be built. And so if a majority of the voters in all those towns approve it, then they can go forward and build the project. So then what each town has to do is each town has to decide, well, how are we going to finance this thing? And some towns are going to, be going, I'm sure, looking to the voters to approve a ballot initiative that says, can we exempt this additional assessment from the regional school districts from the limitations of Proposition 2.5? Because we can't afford to pay for it within our existing tax levy structure without cutting some other operations significantly.
Yeah, definitely something that communities on Cape Cod are going to have to deal with. Do we have a timeline for when the approval of the building, the project to build the new high school, would come before voters?
Yeah, the regional school district has indicated that they've contacted every town clerk involved with and are targeting, I believe it's October 24th, 2017 is the date for the vote, for the district-wide vote.
And will there be any, do you know of, I know this isn't your field, you're the finance director, but have you heard or will there be any information sessions for residents of these communities?
Yeah, there will be a whole campaign that goes along with this. The regional school district officials, I'm sure, will be reaching out to all towns involved and wanting to share all the information associated with this project with every elected official in every single one of those towns to just educate them as to, why they chose to go this route, how much it's going to estimated to cost, and so forth. So there will be a lot of public information coming out, I would anticipate, from the regional school district.
Great. Well, thank you. We will keep our eye out for those meetings coming up, and thank you for giving us this overview. We really appreciate it, and thank you so much for talking with us today.
Okay, Sarah.
All right, talk to you soon. Bye-bye. Our guest today, of course, Finance Director Mark Milne. The state's Alcohol Beverage Control Commission says Barnstable is entitled to a few more seasonal liquor licenses. We're going to learn more with Consumer Affairs Supervisor Elizabeth Hartsgrove. Joining me now, of course, live in studio, we have Elizabeth Hartsgrove, Consumer Affairs Supervisor. I really wanted to bring you in to learn a little bit more about some things happening on the licensing authority. I was watching the licensing authority. Apparently, there is an opportunity for Barnstable to possibly have a few more seasonal liquor store licenses. Yeah. So when I heard that, lots of questions popped into my head. One, I didn't know you could have a seasonal liquor license.
Yeah, it's kind of unusual for more year-round communities, especially around the Boston area, to have seasonal licenses, but the state does provide that option for seasonal communities such as on the Cape, and Barnstable is one of those.
And they really do look at the numbers. So they look at how many people are living in your town year-round versus how many people are coming in the summertime.
That's correct.
So with that influx of people, it does allow for some seasonal liquor licenses.
Yeah, they leave it up to each community to depend on if they want it or not. But it is available, based on population. Year-round annual licenses are based on the annual population. And then the seasonals are based on the increase, and that's all determined by the town clerks. That's pretty much it in a nutshell.
It'll be really interesting, too, to see how this is decided, because this is something that the licensing authority is going to discuss. Is there going to be a public hearing to allow feedback from residents in our town?
As of right now, it is a discussion solely, and it's up to the chairman of the authority whether or not he allows public input. It is in a public setting, it's at a public meeting, so the public is allowed and invited to sit and listen to the discussion. But as of right now, if it's a rule and regulation, then it would have to go through a public hearing process. But if it is a criteria or a procedure that the board wants to follow in the future, then it is something that the board could act upon at that meeting.
And interesting.
Yes.
So. Good to know. Definitely good to know.
Yeah.
You know, it's tough, too. I think it'll be an interesting discussion to see. They're going to discuss this, I think, March 1st. Is that right?
The 6th. March 6th. Yes.
At their meeting, the 6th.
Yes.
Very interesting discussions. Do you know, are there any businesses interested in obtaining some of these seasonal liquor licenses?
Yes, we have two applications on file currently, one that was actually postponed from the previous meeting, which you did watch, and then there is another one actually advertised for the March 6th meeting. So we have now two applications that are going to be heard after the discussion on the agenda. So, and then we've had interest from another applicant as well. On the March 6th agenda, there is an all-alcohol seasonal package store license application, and then there is one for a beer and wine license. And both applicants previously had annual licenses. So, so it's going to be an interesting dialogue.
Yeah, definitely. What are some of the issues that we need to think about as residents when we increase the amount of, because if the town increases the amount of package stores or seasonal license holders, it really can't go back on that. You can't reduce the amount of liquor licenses,
correct.
Is that right?
Yeah, this is a really big subject that the community needs to be involved with, and I do encourage them to participate and either attend the meeting or forward comments to through email or phone calls or by mail as well. But the board has directed me to look at the feasibility of it, the need of it, and possibly a fee schedule. Currently, we don't have fee schedules for seasonal licenses. However, we just have it in a general category of package stores, beer and wine versus annual. So right now, we have just a blank fee for either one if we do allow the seasonal licenses. But in the future, the board does, if they permit it, then they would like me to actually look at possibly recommending a few little options and changes.
When they say seasonal liquor store, what do they mean? What is the season for
sure.
that? I mean,
yeah.
How many months can they be open? Is there a limit? Are there rules and regulations about that?
Yeah, that's a great question. Seasonal licenses are permitted to be used from April 1st to January 15th. So it does give a little window of break, which a lot of package stores and stores in general here on the Cape actually do close up for that little season, that little portion. So it does help, you know, for some operations to have that option. So.
And then, of course, if it's, say, a location that has another business throughout the year, maybe they have a grocery store
yep.
or a sandwich shop, who knows? That they could obviously continue to operate their, say, sandwich shop.
Yeah.
And maybe just take a break from selling alcohol for a few months.
The good thing is, Barnstable's not the first community to have this, you know, to look into. So there are all these towns on the Cape that have seasonal versus annual licenses. Now, we were the only ones on the Cape that actually combined years ago all of those two categories into one and just have annual. So we're back at the drawing board to see what works for our community now. It's a really great time for us to actually plan towards the future and also incorporate not only the goals of the town council, but other boards and commissions that have a good say in this. We need their input on this to guide the commission to actually act accordingly.
Yeah, very interesting discussions. Lots of big decisions
yeah.
coming up to be made. Thank you so much for joining us today, sort of clearing it all up for us, letting us know what discussions will be had, and we'll interested to see what happens.
Yeah, we'll see you March 6th.
Yeah, thank you so much
thank
for joining
you,
us today. Of course, our guest today, Consumer Affairs Supervisor Elizabeth Hartsgrove. Now we'll learn about a project to dress up downtown with Main Street Business Improvement Executive Director Elizabeth Warfane. A campaign to dress up downtown was very successful for the Hyannis Main Street Business Improvement District. Here with me to discuss that further is Executive Director Elizabeth Warfane. Thank you so much for joining me
Thank
today.
Thank you for having me.
So congratulations on a successful dress up downtown campaign. Let's talk about it for those of our viewers who may not be aware of the campaign. Tell me a little bit about the Dress Up Downtown campaign.
Okay, so what we did was we decided to add vibrancy to the downtown. So through special lighting, which are string lights in the trees year-round, which you've seen at Faneuil Hall, for instance, and a lot of downtowns do it now, and also artwork along the streetscape. We want to make it a little more vibrant and happy and lovely. And in the process, we're actually rebranding the Main Street area. And it's time. I mean, every certain number of years, a place kind of gets a new facelift. And so we're doing that. And so it's very exciting. And we had this campaign. And we had a GoFundMe match grant from the state. They threw out the gauntlet, and we did it. We made the $15,000, and they're going to match us $15,000. But we also made another $13,000 on top of it. So altogether, it's $43,000 we've pulled in.
Wow, wonderful. Yeah. And I think so many people are feeling really encouraged and really want to support projects like this because they see the investment. They see the changes that Main Street has made over the years and how great it is and how special it is. So really to continue that and make everyone, you know, people, there's a difference between going to a mall, say, or a big box store and heading to a place like Main Street. And I think one of the things that you're trying to do or accomplish with this project is really giving that unique small town
heart and
mom and pop shop. You know?
The idea is that people own it. It's not anybody, one person, or it's not the government's downtown. It's all the people's downtown. And people gave $25, and a bank gave $1,000, and a couple on New Year's Eve together gave $1,000 as their New Year's Eve present. Yep, probably don't even know. And so that's wonderful. So we have lots of variety. We have other foundations that gave us money. The town is going to put some trees in. So all together, we have a lot of leverage that came out of this from all types of, you know, places. And the best is the people. And then we'll have a party at the end for our first open streets where all the people who donated are going to be part of it. Again, they're going to see some painting on the streets happening live. You know, we're really partnering with the town on this, with the High Arts District, instead of like silos of people doing different things. All together, we're branding it, and I think that's very exciting. That's a new piece. We're going to brand our maps together, our information kiosks together, the look, our logos. I think it's really going to jive well for the downtown.
Well, you're right. So many different organizations have really worked hard to provide different maps of the area to promote tourism, to promote local businesses, and just as well as just provide visitors an easy guide. So really makes a lot of sense to team up instead of doing three different brochures to have one brochure.
It totally makes sense.
Combining resources and having that one-stop shop is a really great idea. When did you start this project, and when do you expect these finalized maps to be completed?
So we start now. We're starting the meetings this week to work it together like peanut butter and chocolate and marry the maps and make sure that you know, we still have all the right information, but we want to put them in our kiosks as of by Memorial Day. That's when you'll start to see the maps come out. And I'd say by April, really, you'll have seen the artwork get started. And we're going to start the trees pretty immediately in the next few weeks. So, and they take time. So we want to have 18 more trees out there by April.
Oh, I can't wait to see
it. I know.
I can't wait to.
Right? You see a few of them already.
And
right?
you piqued my interest, too, when you started talking about Open Streets. One of my favorite events of the year last year was those two Open Streets events. When do we think those events are going to start happening again this year?
So April 21st and May 23rd have been the penciled-in dates so far.
Wonderful.
And then two in the fall.
Can't wait.
I think it's perfect shoulder season pieces. And the Civic Association, Deb Crow, will talk about it, I'm sure, and Jane Walsh, and they really lead that, and we're one of the partners. But we love that. It's really opened up the downtown to the people.
And you see how many people love to take advantage of getting out and enjoying their community and seeing their friends and neighbors at these events because they've had very successful turnouts. So we're going to mark that on our calendar.
That's right.
Thank you so much for the update today. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Now let's find out what's happening around town in today's community calendar. The Cotuit Library is hosting a family movie marathon this Saturday. Featured movies include Robots and WALL-E. The movie marathon begins this Saturday, February 25th at noon and goes until 4. The movie marathon is free to attend. All are welcome. We'll save the date. A comedy night next month will raise money to support the Barnstable High School After Prom event. The comedy night will feature Barnstable's Jim Ruberti as the MC. Food and a cash bar will be available. There will also be a live and silent auction. The comedy night will be held at the Cape Codder Resort and Spa Saturday, March 11th at 7. For more information, you can visit the Barnstable High School Prom Celebration Facebook page. And I want to be very specific. They write it as Barnstable HS Prom Celebration Facebook page. Now let's take a look at this week's board, committee, and commission schedule. Thanks for joining us today. We'll be back tomorrow with another great show for you. Tomorrow, we'll chat with Town Manager Mark Ells, State Representative Randy Hunt, and Town Counselor Will Crocker. For Barnstable Today, I'm Sarah Mannell.